I call to order this joint hearing of the Foreign Affairs Subcommittee on Europe, Eurasia, and Emerging Threats, as well as Subcommittee on Terrorism, Nonproliferation, and Trade. Today's topic is Islamic Extremism in Chechnya, a Threat to the U.S. Homeland? After Chairman Poe and I have, and the ranking members of two subcommittees, each of us will have 5 minutes to make opening statements. Each member then will have 1 minute to make an opening statement, alternating between majority and minority members. And without objection, all members may have 5 days to submit statements, questions, and extraneous material for the record. Hearing no objection, so ordered. The origins of the terrorist attack in Boston have drawn attention to a region that has not received the study that it deserves. The terrorist brothers had roots in Chechnya, even though they grew up in America and had sought U.S. citizenship. Chechnya is part of the Northern Caucasus, which also includes Dagestan, where the father of the two brothers live. Two major wars have been fought in Chechnya in the 1990s as the province sought independence from Russia. Many Chechens fled to other parts of the region and into Central Asia. Dagestan was not directly involved in the wars, but has certainly been affected by them and is now a hotbed of radical Islamic activity. There are reports of Chechens fighting in Afghanistan against the United States and NATO troops and Chechen networks in Europe. Al-Qaeda has made recruitment of Chechens a priority, and they are thought to have been trained in Pakistan. The appearance of Chechen fighters outside the Northern Caucasus is ominous. The original Chechen uprising against Russia was secular and nationalist. Within this context, there would be no motive for Chechen exiles to attack the United States, especially after we'd given them sanctuary. In the worldview of some Chechens, there has been, obviously, some Chechens have had their worldview radicalized, as was the case of the two Boston terrorists who have turned from young people being raised here into a jihadist mentality of global war against infidels, which includes us. Is this happening on a regional basis, this radicalization that we saw with these two young men? And why is it happening? What outside forces have sought to transform the Northern Caucasus and Central Asia into a region of Muslim extremism, which did not exist before? In particular, what impact has Saudi Arabia played and other Islamic states played in sending money and missionaries to the region to build mosques and schools to impact the minds of young people who make up such a large portion of the population in Central Asia? Greater cooperation with Russia and the governments of Central Asia should be explored in order to properly understand and respond this emerging threat. This part of the world is critical to the future of the human race. If it becomes dominated by a radical version of Islam, it will change the course of history in an extremely negative way. Excuse me. Muslims deserve freedom and progress, but the jihadist's mindset hates freedom and will drown progress in a sea of blood. Even as a minority viewpoint, the radicals have done great damage throughout the Muslim societies from Pakistan to Afghanistan through the Caucasus. And they have attacked the United States as well as Russia. Can I have a glass of water, please? Pardon me, I have a cold today, obviously. We must find ways to expand our long friendship with Muslims in order to build a better future. That future should be of peace and prosperity for all people, especially the people of Central Asia, because all of us deserve to live in such a positive world. And we want to find positive ways of moving forward with these people, and thus we have gathered a panel of experts to give us their advice today. And now the ranking member, Mr. Keating.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Today we're examining a region of the world that up until a week ago most people did not know a great deal about. But the Boston Marathon bombings in my home state changed that. I'd like to take a moment to acknowledge the victims and their families that were forever changed by this senseless act, and thank those in Boston who worked around the clock to save lives and prevent other tragedies from occurring that week. For many, their view of the world has become much smaller as the scope of this investigation grows. Whether there's any connectivity, what happened and began in Boston and Watertown, Massachusetts, has now extended into the North Caucasus. And this committee has a responsibility to gather information about possible threats at home and improve our counterterrorism cooperation with other nations. Although I wish that a discussion in the North Caucasus could have been taken place under different circumstances, this is a discussion worth having, as it highlights why so many of us, particularly on this committee, have concerned ourselves with security, rule of law, and human rights issues abroad. According to the 2012 report from the International Crisis Group, armed conflict in the North Caucasus is the most violent in Europe today. Insurgents seeking a regional political unit founded in Sharia attack Russian officials and security forces whose main responsibility till recently has been a tough focus on eradicating the insurgency with a massive security presence. While this policy has had successes, some 574 insurgents, security forces, and civilians have died through September 2012 in Russia, and there are almost daily attacks in the region and occasionally as far afield as Moscow. It's important to understand that the description of terrorism within Russia and some of the contributing factors April 15th attack applies back here at home as well. Simply put, what began as an ethnic struggle in a faraway land decades ago has fueled into an insurgency that presents a threat to our homeland. Our world is more interconnected than ever, and while we see great strides in bringing together international business groups and communication networks, we've yet to see, at the same time, the cooperation in international security matters and information sharing apparatuses. There is undoubtedly a delicate balance between cooperation with Russia on counterterrorism and concern over Russia's human rights abuses, but in no way should this hinder working together to protect the lives of innocent people. At the end of the day, that's all we want. As the investigation of the Boston Marathon incident continues, I hope that this hearing will be insightful as we move to strengthen our international information sharing and security mechanisms. I look forward to hearing from our panel of witnesses, and I'm particularly excited to have Dr. Fraser, the Europe Director of the International Crisis Group, here with us, who happened to be visiting here. So I want to thank you all for being here and look forward to your testimony. That, Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Thank you very much for that very thoughtful opening statement. And the people who were hurt and killed up in Boston, they're all part of our American family. That's, you know, just like everyone who died in 9/11, we're all part of this American family, and we grieve with you, and we're committed to make sure that these things don't happen to other members of the American family.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
And now I recognize Mr. Poe, who is chairman of a subcommittee of his own, which focuses on such threats of terrorism as well as nonproliferation and trade. Judge Poe.
First, I do want to express my sympathies to the victims of the Boston Marathon, but also praise the first responders and the citizens of Boston on Patriots Day for their united effort to capture these bad guys. There's still much that we don't know about the Sarnia brothers, but I'm confident that we'll get to the bottom of this as the investigation unfolds. Yesterday, we learned that the perpetrators had planned to travel to Times Square in New York after the Boston attack to unleash more mayhem and bombs. They apparently had pipe bombs and another pressure cooker bomb. American people want answers, and so do I. I do want to thank the witnesses for being here. It's unfortunate that no one from the federal government is here, even though they were invited to send at least one person. A lot of questions revolve around the older brother's trip to Russia. The Russians were so worried about him, they asked us to look into him. Less than 3 months before he left for Russia in January of 2012, the CIA successfully pushed to have him put on the U.S. counterterrorism watch list called TIDE. But for some unknown reason, between the time he left for Russia and came back, his name was not a concern of the U.S. government, so U.S. authorities did not flag him. That meant U.S. Customs did not stop and question him, nor did they let the FBI know he was back so the FBI could talk to him. I'm not sure, and I don't know why U.S. authorities would decide the older brother was not a concern while in a foreign country under really suspicious circumstances where known terrorist groups operate. Even the Russians were worried about this. It looks like we may have the same old problem of information sharing or lack of it. In fact, the Washington Post reports this morning that a single U.S. Customs and Border Protection official assigned to the Boston's Joint Terrorism Task Force received a warning that the older brother, a suspected militant, had returned from a leaky trip in Russia. Officials said there's no indication the unidentified customs official provided that information to anybody or any other members of the task force, including the FBI, who had previously interviewed the militant. So 10 years later, after 9/11, we should not be struggling with this same issue of information sharing among American agencies and also communication with foreign governments who are concerned about terrorism as well. We don't know if the attackers had ties directly to Al-Qaeda or affiliates, but the evidence so far suggests a link to Al-Qaeda Inspire magazine produced by Al-Qaeda's group in Yemen. The magazine provides a step-by-step instruction for anyone wanting to build a device like the ones detonated in Boston. The older brother traveled to Russia, then went to Dagestan for 6 months between 2011 and 2012. He might have been radicalized there. We're not yet certain if that is true or by whom. Both brothers were Chechens, and now it seems clear the older brother was the ringleader. Chechnya knows conflict and controversy. They've been dealing with it for the last 20 years. We can be sure there's no shortage of bad guys in places like Dagestan just waiting to get their hands on young wannabe jihadists. Bin Laden encouraged Saudis to go to Chechnya to fight Russia. Yet another outlet for extremists is against the United States and coalition forces on the battlefields of Afghanistan. Elsewhere, if a Chechen jihadist cannot attack a Russian target, then a soft target in his own city in America or Europe is the next best option. In fact, Al-Qaeda has been encouraging those types of attacks for years, according to terrorism expert Bruce Riddell from the Brookings Institute. Al-Qaeda says Islam is under attack from every direction, and jihadist answer is to strike back in New York, Madrid, London, Toulouse, and possibly Boston now. In fact, just days after the Boston attack, authorities in Canada arrested two men for allegedly plotting to blow up a train. Initial reports suggest Al-Qaeda elements in Iran had provided the two men with direction, guidance, and information. Al-Qaeda and its affiliates' call to global jihad is alive and well and lives in jihadist forums, social media outlets, and the like. So we have many questions that we need answers from. The threat from terrorist attacks around the world did not die with bin Laden. We must be realistic and understand that and find out specifically what is taking place in Chechnya and how that affects the United States. And I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much for that very thoughtful and forceful opening statement. Anyone else have a desire for an opening statement? If not, let me note that we did try to get a State Department representative here with us today. We wanted them to send a witness to tell us what they thought was going on in Central Asia and Chechnya and the Caucasus region, but they declined, and they're too busy to send someone here to the United States Congress and to speak with the American people through public hearings like this. They're just too busy on other matters. That may well be part of the problem in that this region has not gotten the attention that it deserves. There's a map of the region over there, but let us just note that Central Asia, as we are describing in the Caucasus, represent a huge chunk of the planet, and if that area comes under the domination of radical Islam that makes it its job to attack the United States or to attack other countries, not just the United States, but other non-Muslim people, that will be a disaster for this, for every person on this planet. That will be usher us into an era that will be hard, of violence and mayhem that will be hard to get out of. So we need to pay attention to the Caucasus, and we need to work with those people who will work with us to see that that does not happen. And I don't believe that we have worked, number one, paid attention here until it stung us, as it did in Boston and as it did on 9/11. And we have also not been cooperating and working as hard as we can with those other countries. And I would put my finger on Russia, where we could have well worked and a lot closer with Russia than we have been. And as the judge pointed out, that and as the ranking member pointed out, that we can do so without giving up our commitment to human rights and not complain when if the Russians are doing something wrong, they can accept some criticism, as we can when we do things that are wrong. But that should not prevent us from joining forces against radical Islam, which threatens to kill our children in order to terrorize the world. And if they take over and dominate an area the size of Central Asia, everybody in the world is in for trouble. Now, with that said, we've got some very fine witnesses. Paul Goebel is a professor at the Institute of World Politics. He was director of research and publications at the Azerbaijan Diplomatic Academy. Earlier, he served as vice dean of the social sciences and humanities at EventID's University and in Estonia, and a senior research associate at the Euro College of the University of Tartu, which is also in Estonia. He served in various capacities in the United States State Department, the Central Intelligence Agency, the Voice of America, and Radio Free Europe, and Radio Liberty, and at the Carnegie Endowment for Peace. Next, we have Andreak Migranyan. I hope I pronounced that correctly. And let me just note that I took this upon myself to reach out to the Russian embassy and to our Russian counterparts and to see if they could maybe recommend someone who could come here and discuss this very important issue and how it's important to both of us. And we appreciate you being with us today. And I'm sorry that the Russian embassy can send people, but the State Department can't. He is a director of the New York City branch of the Institute for Democracy and Cooperation. He was a member of the Presidential Council of the Russian Federation between 1993 and 2000. Vice President of the Reforma Foundation, and among his many publications are the books Russia, From Chaos to Order, A Russian Search for Identity, and Democracy and Morality. He was awarded with the Russian Medal of Honor by a presidential decree in 2009. We also have with us Dr. Craig Douglas Albert. He's a professor of political science, at Georgia Regents University in Augusta, where he specializes in the study of ethnic group identity. His research has concentrated on the Chechnyan and the Kurds. That's very interesting. and recent working on papers entitled Things Fall Apart, A Political Opportunity Model for the Chechen Resistance. He holds an MA and a PhD from the University of Connecticut. And finally, we have Dr. Sabine Freiser. Is it Freiser or Freiser? Freiser? Freiser. Who joined the International Crisis Group in 2004. She currently serves as the Istanbul-based director of the European Program. In this role, Sabine oversees projects covering the Caucasus, both north and south, Bosnia, Kosovo, Serbia, Turkey, and Cyprus. Before joining the Crisis Group, she served as political officer in the OSCE Election of Observation Missions in Azerbaijan and Georgia from 2003 to 2004. She has a PhD from the London School of Economics and a master's from the College of Europe in Belgium, which she obtained as a Fulbright scholar. So we welcome our witnesses today, and we would ask if you could try to keep your testimony to 5 minutes. And anything can be submitted for the record, but then we will come back and ask questions once there has been, everyone has testified. If there is a vote, it is the intention of this chair to recess if we have not had our time to ask the questions, and then to come back immediately after the last vote. And I understand there's only going to be two or three votes, so it should not be more than 20 minutes or a half an hour. So we would start with Mr. Goebel.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for inviting me, and thank you for holding a hearing on such an important topic. Allow me to begin by associating myself with what you and other members of the committee have said about our common horror at what happened in Boston and about the enormous respect we have for the people of Boston and the way they responded. It was quite impressive. I must say that I also want to share, to associate myself with the chairman's remarks about the Department of State's representation. As late as the summer of 1989, I was the only person employed in the U.S. government working on the non-Russian peoples of the Soviet Union. That was quite amazing given everything that was happening, and it was certainly my hope that after the Soviet Union came apart, the number of people who would be working in those areas and have expertise on it would grow and we would all benefit from it. It is probably inevitable whenever something that we know little about, a place or a people, comes into our consciousness, that we jump rather quickly to oversimplifications based on our knowledge from elsewhere. That is certainly what has happened in the response to what happened, the horror in Boston. We have had people use terminology which has been imported without much thought about what it means. And I think it's terribly important to unpack some of this oversimplistic language and to understand what is really going on, lest we be in a position to fight it, and also even more, and more immediately anyway, lest we be manipulated in a way that's against American national interests. In my remarks, I would like to focus on three elements of this oversimplification. First has to do with Islam, second has to do with ethnicity, specifically in the North Caucasus, and third has to do with the experience of emigration among peoples of the North Caucasus, not only in this country, but in Western Europe. Islam in the North Caucasus is among the most varied phenomenon in the world. It came in three different ways, beginning in the 8th century in Dagestan, and not until the 18th century in Chechnya. Dagestan is a vastly more Islamic place. I'm much more worried about the 6 months in Dagestan than I am the Chechen background. It is also very differently in how tightly it is held by people there and how much it motivates actions. Many of the people who are called Muslims or call themselves Muslims in this part of the world know nothing about their faith. They are what the Soviets called ethnic Muslims. They know they're Muslims. They don't know what it means. President Jokhar Dudayev of Chechnya once told me that he was a good Muslim. He prayed three times a day. As a good Muslim would know that you pray five times a day, but he'd been a member of the Communist Party since the age of 18 and a major general in the Soviet Air Force, so he did not know. Unfortunately, we use the term Muslim without always an appreciation of the fact that what happened has happened in the North Caucasus and even more in Central Asia. Since 1991, reflects the experiences of a community that had an identity but had no content for that identity, and suddenly there were people available to provide that content. Prior to 1991, very few of these people could have told you the difference between one surah of the Quran and another. The Quran was only published twice in Soviet times for people there, so they didn't know very much. I believe that the opening of the southern border of what had been the USSR may prove ultimately more fateful for the United States than the opening of the western border to Europe. I want to give you four statistics, pairs of statistics. In 1991 in the Russian Federation, there were 150 mosques. Today, there are 8,800. In 1991, there were 40 people who went on the Hajj, people who traveled to Mecca. This past year, there were 40,000. A factor of a 1,000 increase. The number of missionaries coming in from the Middle East, Turkey and Saudi, and the Turks are quite heavily involved, went from zero in 1991 to a high of about 2,500 in the late 90s, and it's now somewhere between 1,200 and 1,500. And the number of Muslims studying abroad in madrasas and Islamic universities went from four in 1991, at least three of whom were working for the KGB, and now to a figure of probably about 1,200, again down from the numbers of 2,000 plus at the end of the 90s. Those numbers are even more dramatic in Central Asia. I hope we can come back to that, but I think that's important. Second, with respect to ethnicity, ethnicity was constructed. These people have various experiences with what it means. Most of the Chechens were, in fact, committed ethno-nationalists. The idea that they are Islamist nationalists is simply untrue. There are some who are, but overwhelmingly, it is not the case. If you look at Central Asia, you will see that is also true. And the experience of emigration means that people are in extremists because they are up against very difficult situations. And one thing that has not been focused on in the discussion of Boston is that many Chechens feel they are about to be returned to the Russian Federation or to Chechnya because of what has been happening thanks to Russian pressure in Austria, Germany, Belgium, and elsewhere in Western Europe. People who fear they have no good options may do really bad things. Three quick conclusions. First, I think we are learning that if we are going to compete in this kind of ideological contest, and it is an ideological contest, police power must be used, but it will never be sufficient to solve the problem. Second, we need to recognize that many of the problems we face now, both with regard to Islam in North Caucasus and Central Asia and with regard to ethnicity in North Caucasus and Central Asia, are a reflection of the actions of Moscow both before 1991 and after that time. We have to cooperate with the Russians in certain respects, but we have to recognize that they are part of the problem too, and that has to be insisted upon. And third, we need to understand that some of the things that are coming out in the coverage of the two terrorists shows that there are some optimistic reasons for looking at Islam, that more and more Muslims are learning the details of their faith. 40 years ago, when I started studying it, you couldn't get a translation of the Quran in English that didn't say an interpretation. Now there are discussions of what is canonical, what translations are canonical. We know what happened when the Bible was translated into German and English in the 15th century. It led to the Reformation, the Renaissance, and modernity. It is entirely possible that we will see the same kind of thing happen in the world of Islam, and we will see the same kind of troubles over the next three or four generations that the people of Western Europe understood. Thank you very much.
That last point you made is very interesting. I never thought of that before, and thank you. Dr. Albert.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, fellow panelists, for having me here today. I appreciate the opportunity to speak about Islamic extremism in Chechnya. I would also like to remark my comments are directed mostly at the Islamic extremists inside Chechnya and Dagestan and don't reflect the general population of Chechnya as well. That is a more ethno-nationalist approach, as Professor Goebel said. So this pertains directly to the Islamist threat inside the area. There are some Islamist elements inside Chechnya and the surrounding Caucasus regions, although their connection to any larger global jihadist network is a question for debate. It is this author's opinion that although there is an Islamist presence in the Chechen region, it possesses little strategic threat to the United States, although it may pose a modest threat to the United States' forces worldwide. The largest contemporary Islamist threat in Chechnya and Dagestan is the Caucasus Emirate, founded in 2007. The CE is currently led by Dukul Umarov and was officially created to replace the failing separatist government of the region, the Chechen Republic of Ichkeria. While the former wanted an independent Chechnya, the CE wants to create an Islamic caliphate that extends beyond the Caucasus region. In fact, it appears the CE has embarked upon a philosophically grand vision of territorial expansion in the past couple of years. The CE has some reported connections to Al-Qaeda, including third-party financing, mainly based in Saudi Arabia. Although there are arguments whether there are larger connections between the CE and Al-Qaeda, there appears to be evidence that the two are connected, if only in a minor way. It is well documented that Al-Qaeda is currently more of a leaderless organization, and thus has resulted to organizing and coordinating its efforts and networks via the internet, which is probably the relationship it has with Chechen jihadists. Therefore, it is more difficult to establish a clear connection between the two, but there is a connection, however small it may be. Although there are some historical links with Chechnya and Al-Qaeda, there's no convincing evidence that Dukul Umarov is a member of Al-Qaeda, but he certainly sympathizes with its larger causes. This can perhaps be demonstrated by the Caucasus Emirate websites that post links to Al-Qaeda documents and Al-Qaeda affiliates, including links to the Al-Qaeda magazine Inspire, which may have helped the Boston bombers develop and deploy their bombs. It must also be mentioned that the tactics and bombs used in Boston resemble attacks carried out in Chechnya, including delayed multiple explosions, although the bombs are made slightly differently. The greater jihadist threat in the Caucasus Mountains is not a nationalistic Chechen movement and doesn't involve most of the Chechens, probably less than 1% of the population at all sympathize with this type of movement, but it is a larger network of jihadists connected and networked to the global jihad. It is also more of a Caucasian threat than a Chechen threat, emanating mostly from individuals of Dagestan. It is important to emphasize that an attack on the United States' mainland from the Caucasus Emirates or other Chechen Caucasian groups is highly unlikely. The Chechens are generally not preoccupied with the United States. However, one has to consider if the Chechens do become more involved with the larger global jihadi network, whether they may consider attacking the U.S. homeland. With that considered, one would still conclude that an attack in the U.S. is highly unlikely by these individuals. In fact, CE Commands has recently stated that the larger confederated network has had nothing to do with the planning, coordinating, or financing the attacks in Boston. Dukul Umarov has also recently ordered his units and all jihadist elements inside the Caucasus not to attack civilians at all anywhere, and he has emphasized that his organization has no conflict with the United States. The CE and nationalist groups inside Chechnya direct most of their concerns towards combating the Russian Federation. Especially with the 2014 Winter Olympics approaching, it can be hypothesized that their efforts are being solely directed at targeting those sporting events or planning other attacks inside and around Russia, especially inside Dagestan. It is likely, however, that U.S. military, security, and perhaps government forces that are combating jihadist elements worldwide will face a continued threat from individuals from the Chechen area. The U.S. has already faced these foes from the Caucasus in both Iraq and Afghanistan, and we can also safely predict that where there is a jihadist foothold or where there is a chance of gaining ground for Islamist forces, some Chechens will be found there, as is recently reported in the Syrian civil war. Unless some more details are made available about the Boston bombers' possible training in the Caucasus, however, in Dagestan, I think it is highly unlikely that there is any reasonable strategic threat planned against the United States by the Chechens. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. We'll have some questions for you later. And, sir, and again, McGranan. But you have to punch your button there. Thank you for joining us today, and we really appreciate hearing from a point of view that we wouldn't hear otherwise, and I think we should, so you may proceed.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It's a privilege for me to be here and to share some views concerning Russia's perception concerning all these events which happened in Boston. First of all, I would like to emphasize that these attacks in Boston have provoked feelings of solidarity with the American people and especially with the citizen of Boston among Russian people and Russian leadership. And this is the second time when President Putin, after 9/11, expressed his readiness immediately to cooperate with American authorities in order to find out what happened and how we can eradicate the reasons and causes which brought to this tragedy. But what is in Russia, you know, in Russia, there is, of course, a kind of, you know, uneasiness during this previous 2 decades when Russia was fighting against Chechen terrorists. Russia didn't get enough understanding, empathy, and support from our Western partners. And this is something which really is in public opinion, in mood of politicians. And by the way, yesterday Putin, in his direct line with the people, 5 hours he was talking to the people. He talked a lot about this events in Boston and the terrorism, and he said that Russia was the victim of international terrorism. In Russia, from Middle Eastern countries, from other places, Muslim radicals and terrorists were coming and supporting Chechen terrorists, and unfortunately, our Western partners were very, you know, reserved in order to express their support. And this is, I think, one of the reasons is that even now, when you look at the coverage of the events in Boston, a lot of people are talking about Stalin's deportations, about, you know, psychological problems concerning these people who grew up, and about these injustices which Russian authorities executed against the people, indirectly trying to justify some motives. But, you know, I think America now faced with this homegrown terrorism, I think is becoming more and more aware that without, you know, no motives can justify the terrorism and mass killings of innocent civilians independently because no retaliation can be justified if some governments are acting in some places like this. Tsarnaev brothers were talking about America's war in Iraq or Afghanistan, and might be this is the reason why they acted this way. And another important problem is that, of course, Russia wanted to get back and extradite some leaders of Chechen terrorists from UK and from United States. For example, Ahmad Zakayev was in United Kingdom and now still is here. He's self-proclaimed prime minister of Chechen Republic of Ichkeria. Or Ilyas Akhmadov, by the way, who the former minister of foreign affairs of Chechen Republic of Ichkeria. By the way, he got asylum in Boston when he left Russia. And unfortunately, neither American nor British side, you know, cooperated with Russians in order to extradite this terrorist who considered in Russia as terrorists. But the problem is that I would like to say that Chechen terrorism crossed the border of Russia, and now we have information in Russian secret services and Russian media that Chechens are fighting in Afghanistan, and they are fighting against Americans, they are fighting against NATO. You mentioned that they are members of some groups in Europe. They are now fighting in Syria, and American American politicians and American media is supportive to some, at least, groups of these rebels who are fighting against legitimate government in that country, which means that this we heard that some fighters over there, they are putting the signs that we are fighting today here, and if we win, then we are going to fight in Russia, returning back to Russia. But summing up what I said, in Russia, the general mood is that we have to understand that we Russians have a common interest and overlapping interest with the United States, and we have disagreements. And after Guantanamo and Abu Ghraib, not everyone in Russia believes that American secret services consist on knights on white horses, but our imperfections should not prevent us from realizing that we are facing a common enemy, and to cooperate against it is both common sense and inherently moral.
Thank you very much for that testimony, and we recognize the frustration of someone who sees acts of terrorism being committed against his own people that are very clear, and not the outrage and attitude here that we would expect, that he would expect from a decent people, such as the people of the United States. We'll go into that in the question and answer section. Mr. Royce? We are very pleased to have the chairman of the full committee, Ed Royce. Ed, would you like to make a statement?
You know, I appreciate that opportunity, Mr. Chairman, but I think I'll defer and allow the witnesses each to testify, and then if I might, I might ask a question. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
We'll put you up front. And finally, Dr. Freiser.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman and ranking members, for the opportunity to present today. I want to commend the subcommittee for focusing their attention on the North Caucasus during such a critical time. A few words about Crisis Group. Crisis Group is an independent, nonpartisan, non-governmental organization that provides field-based analysis, policy advice, and recommendations to governments, the United Nations, the European Union, and other multilateral organizations on the prevention and resolution of deadly conflict. Ambassador Thomas Pickering is our current chairman, and Louise Arbour, the former chief prosecutor at the International Criminal Tribunal for Rwanda and the former Yugoslavia, and also the former UN High Commissioner for Human Rights, is our current president. Crisis Group began a North Caucasus project in 2012 and has written two background reports that were published in October. The first report is called The North Caucasus, The Challenges of Integration, Ethnicity, and Conflict. And the second report is called The North Caucasus, The Challenges of Integration, Islam, the Insurgency, and Counterinsurgency. I would respectfully ask that these reports be incorporated into the committee record.
Without objection.
Thank you. A third report, which will come out early this summer, will look at the institutional causes of conflict in the North Caucasus, and that report will also have a series of recommendations on how to deal with the violence in the North Caucasus. I should say that our staff travels frequently to the North Caucasus throughout the region, talking to a very large number of different interlocutors. I understand that these hearings take place in the aftermath of the Boston bombings, and I would like to also express the condolences of International Crisis Group, of all of our staff working around the world for these events. There are two primary causes for conflict in the North Caucasus. It's ethnic conflict and the Islamic insurgency. Let me discuss a little bit by talking about the ethnic conflict. During the early 1990s, separatists sought full independence for Chechnya, but the failure of their state-building project and their expanded use of armed force, including of terrorism, brought a massive and at times indiscriminate Russian response during two wars in Chechnya. Since 2003, the situation in Chechnya has largely stabilized with a process of Chechenization by the Russian government, which means handing over most economic and political power to local Chechen authorities. But having said that, several inter-ethnic conflicts continue to exist in the region. Sometimes these do lead to violence. Very often they're about land and they're about control of power, local power and economic resources. But we also see some conflicts between some of the republics, for example, between Chechnya and Ingushetia, between Ingushetia and North Ossetia. So you still see tensions at the local level, which are primarily ethnic based. The other main source of conflict, which is the one that I think is the main issue of today, is the insurgency. Now, what we should say is that the insurgency feeds off the ethnic conflicts. So a lot of young people who in the past 20 years ago might have joined ethnic movements or nationalist movements now choose instead to join the insurgency. The main organization that is mobilizing the insurgency is the Caucasus Emirates, the Emirat Kafkaz, which was proclaimed in 2007 as a final step of the transformation of the Chechen separatist movement into a regional-wide Islamist project. It is recognized as a terrorist organization by Russia and by the United States and by many others. It operates across the North Caucasus, attracting youth of all different types of ethnicities. Predominantly, it attacks federal forces and local police, but also civil servants and religious leaders. It has a unified force, a unified cause, a very strong structure with a leadership. Predominantly, it is local. Predominantly, it is local funded, and it has predominantly a local aspirations. Today, rarely a day goes by without an attack in Russia. Some 750 people were killed in 2011, and almost the same number were killed in 2012. So far this year, just in the Republic of Dagestan, 67 people were killed. We'll all remember, of course, the bombing of the Domodedovo airport in Moscow in January 2011 that killed 37. The vast majority of attacks are against security services, local officials, and traditional clergy. In February 2012, the head of the Caucasus Emirates said that he will no longer be targeting civilians. However, of course, in attacks against officials and security services, there are important civilian casualties. The government's main response until now has been a very tough focus on eradicating the insurgency with a massive security presence. For example, just a few days ago, between the 11th and 21st of April, there was a major security operation in Dagestan and the village of Guimuri, which resulted in the displacement of 5,000 people. But the Russian government has also began to open some room and started applying a longer-term comprehensive approach to counterterrorism. And I believe that it's this approach that should be supported. Finally, the North Caucasus integration into the rest of Russia is essential for security and for healthy ethnic relations in the country. The spread of violence from Chechnya to neighboring republics, high losses among civilians, military, and the insurgents, and a deteriorating ethnic relations countrywide indicate that more effective and comprehensive approaches are needed to deal with these very complex root causes of the conflict. Thank you very much.
Thank you, and we appreciate all of our witnesses today. And I'm going to recognize now the chairman of the full committee for a statement or questions, whichever he chooses, and what time he'd like to consume.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate that. One of the observations I would make is that in my conversations with Duma members from southern Russia, two physicians that I can think of, both Muslims from Dagestan, they shared with me the way in which this Chechen Al-Qaeda-linked organization was going house to house in their state, which neighbors Chechnya, and giving young men an option of either joining the movement, the jihad, as they called it, or killing them. And as they related to me, this was much more than just a movement for Chechnyan independence. Indeed, it was much more ambitious because the idea was a caliphate for the whole region, right? A caliphate, well, you see Chechnyans now fighting in Afghanistan. You see them carrying out assassinations in Pakistan, certainly all over Central Asia. And in terms of the violence in all of this, the Al-Qaeda-linked groups have developed really a methodology with the use of suicide bombings that they've carried to quite an extent. You've talked about the attack on the school where you have over 500 casualties are dead, most of them children. But this is a fairly regular occurrence in southern Russia today. Even in Moscow, when these Chechnyan Al-Qaeda-linked fighters get into the city. It's pretty horrific what they do in the subways or in government buildings, the number of people killed. The question going forward is, with this commitment now to a wider caliphate, and given that it encompasses such a large geographic area, the attempt to convert moderate Muslims, I think, is a major challenge. I talked to a village leader who was Kyrgyz, and he told me about the situation in his village where 12 young men were receiving instruction in jihad. They had agreed to go to a madrasa to get an education, but all 12 were decapitated. And he said, this is not a local Kyrgyz custom in Kyrgyzstan. This is the importation or the change of a culture. And gradually we're changing our culture to this Al-Qaeda, psychology. And that it's a Gulf state culture in his mind. That's what he said. It's a Gulf state culture in terms of capitation. But with that and with the kinds of mass killings that we're doing, we're changing culture. I was going to ask you about that because it's really a struggle within these societies. And the two physicians that I knew serving in the Duma felt they were losing that struggle. Just your insights.
Thank you for raising this question. I would like say that Dr. Goebel was absolutely right. Situation is now much worse in Dagestan rather than in Chechnya. The problem is that Dagestan is multi-ethnic. There is a serious strained relations between different ethnic groups. It's more prone to Wahhabism, and Wahhabism is coming from Saudi Arabia, and the money is coming, the people are coming from there, and the power is very weak. And this is the problem which you, I think, can understand. You have a strong man in Chechnya, Ahmad Kadyrov, and no terrorist acts, or at least almost no terrorist acts. And you have a weak institution and weak power in Dagestan, and you have a lot of them every day practically, and a lot of losses, which means this is the problem of security and democracy.
Well, I think it might be a little more complicated than that, because we're looking at terrorist attacks, not just in these two states, but in many states across southern Russia. And in Moscow as well. And with all the security in Moscow, they're not able to protect the subways. They're not able to protect. You had an observation.
Push yes. Your button.
Excuse me. What we are seeing is an effort to recruit people who identify themselves as Muslims, but the effort to recruit people who are committed Muslims, that is people who really know about Islam, has failed, even in Dagestan, that where the Saudi missionaries have been most successful is in areas where people don't know very much about Islam. They identify as Islam, but there's someone else is telling them what it means. This is a huge problem, because if you see people acquire more Islamic knowledge, there is a view here in this country that as people learn more about a religion, they will tend to become more fundamentalist. The fact is, as people learn more about a religion, they become more committed to whatever the religion teaches, and they become protected against efforts to change their direction. In the case of the people of the North Caucasus and Central Asia, and the something between 15 and 18 million Muslim population elsewhere in the Russian Federation, what we have are people who do not have that kind of training and therefore are more susceptible for recruitment. I think it's very important to understand that there's a process of immunization. I know many, many Muslims in Tatarstan, in the middle of Volga. Those who know a very great deal about Islam are able to say absolutely no to the missionaries come from Saudi Arabia. The people who know much less about Islam are far more likely to be recruited because they're waiting for someone to tell them what it means.
Thank you, Mr. Goebel. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, and we now recognize Mr. Brad Sherman, ranking member on the Terrorism Subcommittee. for his opening statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Those who have seen me on this committee have seen me use my question time to pontificate. This is my but I am just filled with so many questions that I'm going to lay some out now using my pontification time for question to lay out some questions, and I'll invite the panel to respond later. Well, one relates to the history of the area where we're told that Stalin deported the entire Chechen population, but this raises the question, how many people were deported, how many returned, and who in the heck was living in Chechnya in the meantime, and how were they persuaded to leave? We see a over 200-year alliance between the Ben Saud family and Wahhabi Islam. And I think it may be go beyond this hearing, but I mean, this is both an alliance and very dangerous to the Saudi royal family, since most of those who want to kill the leaders of Saudi Arabia are motivated by an Islam that seems almost indistinguishable for me from to the Islam that is being funded by and propagated by money that comes from the Gulf and either with the permission of or out of the pockets of the Saudi royal family. I'm going to be asking what are the training facilities in Chechnya and Dagestan? We all knew that Al-Qaeda was operating in Afghanistan, taking in people from all over the world, training thousands of them. Is there anything even on a smaller scale in Chechnya, Dagestan? We saw these brothers be unfortunately effective in the bombing and incredibly amateurish after the bombing. And so it'd be interesting to see whether they got any training beyond what they saw on the internet for the bombing, and we won't know that in these hearings, but perhaps we'll know whether there's a mini Al-Qaeda, which means the base. Is there a training base for extremist Islam in the Chechen region? I think I'll save the rest of my questions for question time and yield back.
Thank you very much. And we will now proceed to our questions and dialogue. Let me begin by saying that years ago, and just a related story, years ago there was, and I think it was in 2004, the Chechen terrorists took over a school in, is it Barcelona? Is that the how you pronounce it? Mm-hmm. In Russia, Chechnya. Is that city part of Chechnya, or is it just part of Russia? And it's not. It's a Russian city, Russian school. And the terrorists there murdered, in the end, 180 children lost their lives. Children. And I remember calling the White House personally, and I talked directly to Condoleezza Rice and told her, now is the time that we can establish a close and new and positive relationship with Russia and recruit them to work with us on in areas of mutual interest that we couldn't do before. Now is the time for us to stand with these folks. And go, and I said, send President Bush over there to stand next to Putin and say that Americans stand shoulder to shoulder with the people of Russia, and yes, the government of Russia, in opposing and defeating those who would murder children in order to obtain their political ends. As we've seen in Boston, the young man who put the bomb down did so right behind an 8-year-old boy. Now, the answer was evident that no, the president didn't go there. Let's also note that how many people here know that the Russians have built a monument in memory of the people of who were killed, the Americans killed in 9/11. How many know that right across from where the World Trade Center was, in looking across the bay, there's a beautiful monument that was built by the Russian people and the Russian government, expressing solidarity in the sorrow and heartache of seeing their people, ordinary people, Americans and citizens, young people, old people, losing their lives like this to a terrorist attack. Well, today I would hope that what happened in Boston and the fact that it related directly back to Russia and Chechnya in terms of there's a line we can draw, that I hope that will motivate us to work with Russia in order to defeat those who would murder children in order to obtain their goals. Now, the Chechen independence movement was originally secular and nationalist. What I'm talking about is, I do not understand how radical Islam, talking about God and Allah, as they say, that they seem to be the ones who justify acts and make legitimate acts of murdering innocent people who are non-combatants and targeting non-combatants, not targeting the army of someone, but targeting non-combatants. That is being done to terrorize us into submitting to some of their radical religious thought, I guess. But in the beginning, the Chechen independence movement was secular and nationalist. Now it appears that radical Islamist ideology has pretty much dominating that independence movement. And these are people who now, this radical Islamic ideology makes a common jihad against Christians, Jews, and Hindus throughout the world. Where'd that come from? How did that happen? I'm asking this of the panel. And was this the financing of Wahhabi extremism and financing of these mosques? Did that have something to do with this? And what kind of threat in the future? And also, let me note, they didn't permit in Uzbekistan the Saudis to come in and build their mosques. They were criticized here as that's a violation of their human rights. But we know that the Saudi purpose of doing this was to develop a brand of Islam that will target and kill children. So, number one, how did it become this radical ideology, and is there a way to counter that? And is Uzbekistan wrong, and are we right to condemn Uzbekistan for not allowing them to build our mosques? Goebel is really anxious here. Go right ahead.
Well, as someone who was quite involved with Joker Dudayev, who, after all, prevented the killing of Boris Yeltsin in January of 91 and also prevented the extension of killings from Vilnius and Riga to go to Tallinn at that time, I can testify that the Chechen national movement was completely secular. The process by which you saw a change is not that the entire movement changed, but the part that got attention changed. It was a product of, I believe, three different factors. The first was that the Chechen national movement, as articulated by Dzhokhar Dudayev, believed that Chechens as a nation had a right to independence the same way the Estonians or the Latvians or anyone else. That was his personal belief. When the Chechens did not get any support for their position in the West, they began looking for support elsewhere. Disappointed in our not having supported us, they turned to look at the people who, the only people who were prepared to say they were supporting them. Second, I mentioned some numbers about the number of people going on the Hajj. This is a good indication of how intense you have. Over the last 22 years, Chechens have formed roughly 40% of the Hajis coming from the Russian Federation, even though the Chechens form less than 1% of the population of the Russian Federation. So you have a lot of people being exposed. And the third thing is there's been money. I mean, real money coming in from the Saudis, and not just the Saudis, a number of other people too, to build various kinds of things. I would argue that there is still a Chechen national movement which is committed to a secular and free Chechnya. Unfortunately, it gets very little attention, and it gets very little attention in Chechnya because it's been so unsuccessful.
when people are unsuccessful, when the people they hope will be their allies don't turn out to be, it's not surprising that they turn to other people who are willing to support them. And unfortunately, some of the people they turn to in this instance have, as you've quite properly pointed out, truly criminal and immoral agendas.
Let me just note, and then we'll go to the your ranking member, just say, I can't imagine if a number of Western countries where people would be so committed to their national independence and they were so frustrated that they weren't getting outside support, that they would go to ally themselves with those who want them and help them murder large numbers of children. This is not an excuse. Them not getting support of the United States or from people who believe in democracy is no excuse to help people who are willing to murder, target children.
Mr. Chairman, I was not seeking to provide an excuse. That. I'm just trying to provide an explanation and answer because it is absolutely true. What was tragic is that those people who recognized what was going on were almost entirely ignored, and that there was a lot that could have been done and should have been done and wasn't done.
Right.
I certainly do not believe that we bear responsibility, either then or now, for what happened.
Okay, Mr. Keating.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Dr. Magranian, given your familiarity and connection with the Russian government, I had a question. The FBI, in investigating the Boston Marathon bombings, received information from Russia, but then they sought additional information after their investigation. Can you speak or shed some light on maybe the culture that exists with law enforcement and with security officials in both countries? Could you comment on how it could be improved, perhaps?
My opinion is that, but this is my guess, when I called to Moscow yesterday to talk to some high-ranking people over there, because CNN wanted me to comment about this contacts between security forces, they said, no, they are working now, they are cooperating, and we are not going to make any comments on this. But my personal guess is that this is the problem of distrust between our countries and our security forces. I am afraid that when Russian security law enforcement agencies asked FBI to look at these guys, by inertia, you know, in this country and in the West, still is the dominant, the idea that Russian authorities are oppressing them. This is some Russian plot. This is not the terrorism. It's something else. That's why I am afraid that they just didn't pay enough attention to these warnings on behalf of Russians. As a result, this, as I said in my preliminary, statement, there is a kind of among Russian law enforcement authorities, and especially political circles, and I know them very well, being in presidential council and working with all these administrations. Since 2001, there is a deep feeling of a betrayal, you know, because Putin was the first who called to Bush. Putin offered every opportunity which Russia had and very strongly cooperated in fighting against Taliban and Al-Qaeda. And in response, Russia, I remember the spiritual situation in Russia at that time. Everybody was thinking that at least we are finishing and putting back this Cold War, all our, distrust, and we are going to cooperate.
One of the things we want to perhaps come of this is a better opportunity to have security advisors and law enforcement work more closely, despite our differences, as difficult as they can be at times, because in both countries. Lives could be lost in the homeland as well, particularly with groups like the Caucasus Emirates, that there are terrorist groups. I had a quick question, though, for Dr. Frieser, if I could, too. We're getting reports that, you know, there are posters coming up in the North Caucasus area and actual support support for the terrorists that conducted the Boston Marathon bombings. I don't know what information you might have in those reports, but this is unusual that there's so much attention focused on the U.S., negative attention. Could you comment on what you might think, in your opinion, in your work with your group? Is there a different viewpoint now towards the United States?
In our reporting so far, we have not really looked at the Russian-United States relationship as relates to the North Caucasus. So I can only answer this question partially. What I can say is that in its statement of last week, what the Caucasus Emirates clearly said is that they are not at war with the United States. So it is not the ambition of the North Caucasus insurgency and terrorist organization, the Caucasus Emirates, to extend its war to the United States, or really to extend it beyond the region of the Caucasus, and including perhaps Central Asia. I think that the posters that you're seeing today are, of course, very troubling, very disturbing, to see that there are people in this region who are taking pleasure of what happened in Boston. Some of this might just be kind of local pride in terms of just family links, but of course this is highly unfortunate, and I don't think it really reflects on the feelings of the general population in the region.
All right, thank you. And I just in closing, I do appreciate Mr. Goebel's efforts to distinguish Muslim religious individuals from some of these extremist groups. It's an important thing to do. With that, I'll turn it back, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
And now, Judge Poe, Chairman of the Subcommittee on Terrorism and Nonproliferation.
Thank you once again for being here. I'm a little irritated that the State Department is not here. This is an important topic. Sure, they don't have all the information yet, but they should at least show up. And it is ironic that the Russian government helped us get a witness here to help us from that perspective. Mr. Coble, you may be the last person in the State Department that worked on this issue. Maybe that's why you're the only one here today. But I do have some concerns. I think we've learned that radical Islamic jihadists do not come from a certain one place area in the world. They come from all over the world, and some are homegrown. Chechnya is one of those areas that we need to focus on, and we need to work with the Russian government on what has taken place there, because what takes place there obviously has been taking place here as well, with the influence and a red line from Dagestan to the United States as far as what criminal activity, terrorist activity, is taking place in our own country. It's interesting that if Dagestan is a place where it's known that is a haven for jihadist philosophy, and that it's growing, why we would not be concerned about someone that's in the United States going to that area for 6 months. I mean, what was he doing for 6 months? Who would this person, the older brother, let's call him, who could he have been meeting with to get an influence on Al-Qaeda or from Al-Qaeda jihadist movements? Enlighten me on that. I can tell, Mr. Goebel, you want to start.
I just want to suggest that one of the insights that Americans have brought to the appearance of terrorism is that it's often bred in failed states where there are no political institutions to run things. It is worth noting that a week ago, the new acting president of Dagestan, Ramazan Abdulatipov, described his republic as a failed state, as a state where political and legal institutions did not work and where it could not control the situation. This opens the door to the kinds of things we've seen elsewhere. failed states, states that cannot control their own population, that cannot operate as a state normally does, inevitably open spaces which are exploited by radicals of various kinds. And in there are places, I am absolutely sure, in Highland Dagestan, where no outside official has ever been. It is that kind of a place, both topographically and demographically. So the possibility of someone going there for 6 months and not being exposed to radicals in one way or another strikes me as slim to none, and that's why I've
It's not the place you would go fishing.
Among other things,
from the United States.
That's right.
Over there.
And it is also a place where you would expect that someone who went that had the troubled biography this gentleman did would end up being an object of interest of not the right kind of people were he there. I'm much more concerned about the 6 months in Dagestan than the fact that the man is an ethnic Chechen.
Let me reclaim my time because I don't have but a minute and a half left. Would you think that maybe we ought to be concerned about that, especially if the Russian government says, hey, this guy they tell us two times that this is somebody that we ought to be concerned about, and all of a sudden he comes back to the United States, maybe a customs official knew it, maybe he didn't, but wouldn't you think in the area of intelligence that ought to raise a red flag? This is not something that should have slipped under the rug. Just snuck in. Dr. Albert, I'll let you just weigh in on that question.
It definitely poses a concern if we didn't communicate properly that he was visiting the area to Dagestan. I want to address the original point also of who could this person have been meeting with in Dagestan that would have posed a threat, and this is particularly the organization known as Sharia Jamaat, which could be a subset of the...
How large is that organization?
It's not very large, but it is probably the most...
Well, how large? Give me some numbers.
Maybe less than 1,000 individuals, but that's just a reasonable conjecture. I don't have much evidence of that. But probably around 1,000 individuals. They're actively recruiting throughout the area as well. It could be larger because it's attached to the Caucasus Emirate as well. It's a confederation of alliances around there.
I'm sorry, Dr. Albert, I need to interrupt you for one last question. Is the influence, the radical jihadist movement, let's just use that phrase, in Dagestan, is it on the increase or is it decreasing? It's something that the Russian government's concerned about. Is it something we should be concerned about as well? Is it on the increase? That's my last question.
Yes, it's on the increase in Dagestan, and it's something we should be concerned about.
All right. I'm out of time. Sorry, Doctor. I'll yield back.
Let me just note that I don't believe that any Americans are concerned if a country decides to have leadership that is religious and they decide that you have groups of people. What we need to be concerned about is if it happens to be a religion that convinces people that part of their faith is to go off and murder other people's children. So if they were taking over that part of that country and they were just people who wanted to exercise their religion and worship God as they see fit, nobody here would have any objection to that at all, or their independence and their right to vote, et cetera. Now, Mr. Sherman.
Thank you. Perhaps they could reset the clock. Does anyone have a little quick history lesson for us as to the Chechen deportations, or Dr. Albert? How many people were kicked out, et cetera?
The entire population in 1944 was deported by Stalin. I think the numbers would be around 800,000, I believe. A quarter of those died in transit, or they were deported to Central Asia. They were allowed to return. Who occupied their homes earlier, I think, was a question. Russia resettled some people from the Russian mainland into the homes inside Chechnya at that time. Khrushchev eventually allowed the Chechens to come back. Some of them, for obvious reasons, chose to stay where they were. Many of them came back. There were issues and ethnic tensions within Chechnya with the people that had resettled in their homes, as you could imagine. This is known as a great trauma or a great tragedy to the ethnic identity of Chechens that this event occurred. It is something very strong in their historical memory.
In 1944, there were Russians living in these homes in an area that had supported 800,000 people. today in Chechnya, how many of those Russians are still there?
It's a good question. You know, after all these wars, though there was a huge propaganda campaign that Russians are killing and massacring all the Chechens, now practically no Russians left in Chechnya.
So there were
They terrorized all of them and kicked them out.
There were tens or hundreds of thousands of Russians in Chechnya.
300,000 Russians lived in Chechnya.
All
practically all of them
were cleansed by this. I want to join Mr. Rohrabacher in his call for better relations between the United States and Moscow. I want to point out that we granted refugee status to this family. That is something we would do only if we're claiming that they're oppressed by the Russian government. And we've seen the outcome. Who can answer the question as to what level of, what are the training bases for extremist Islam in the Dagestan Chechnya area? Is there like a particular site where they have hundreds of people getting military training?
A short answer is that in the 90s, they were training over there in Chechnya, in Ingushetia, in other places, because central government was very weak. Mm-hmm. Now they are limited because practically in Chechnya totally is under the control of Kadyrov, and this Sufi Islam is over there, traditional, mm-hmm. which means they are limiting. Russia, central government is trying to strengthen local presidents and local authorities, mm-hmm. putting these security guys in Ingushetia, and now Ramazan Abdulatip, of whom I know very well.
But there are...
But this is a long-lasting yeah. process.
Now, one thing, the Russian government told us to watch Tamerlan. He spent 6 months in the Russian Federation. How robust is the Russian intelligence and law enforcement system in the Dagestan town where the parents live? Would we expect the Russians to keep track of this individual during his 6 months? Or is this an area where the writ of the government doesn't
The extend? Fact that almost 2 months ago the president of Dagestan was changed proves that really this is a failed state. Institutions are very weak. Bribery is very high. And ethnic lines are too many, because too many ethnic groups, and it's very hard to get lost in that mountainous places where from village to village different languages and different ethnic groups are living.
Mr. Goebel?
There are, within Dagestan, 30 different mutually non-intelligible language groups in an area of...
Just in Dagestan, the Caucasus.
No, this is just in Dagestan. There are 30 different a nation speaking not mutually intelligible languages. Most Dagestanis are tri or quadrilingual as a result, because it's the only way you can function. But what that means is that in many areas, it's very, very difficult from someone from the center, be it Moscow or locally from Makhachkala, to penetrate those language communities. And so a lot goes on that, quite frankly, I think no one either in Makhachkala or Moscow knows.
Thank you.
Mr. Meeks, you have time for a one-minute statement on your part, then we're going to be adjourning this hearing.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I was paying attention closely to the testimony in my office. I was trying to multitask, but I felt compelled to come. I had a question for Mr. Goebel, but because the issue is, I was listening to a lot, and when you talk about the wide open territory that is in the terrain that is not manageable, it reminded me somewhat of what was taking place in the Western Hemisphere in Colombia at a time, and we had tried to bring some of those individuals back into society again. Whether or not there's something that was being done, or my issue in the middle, so that those who are being taken toward terrorists and terrorist actions, to bring them back into society so that they can re-assimilate into culture. Mr. Goebel, real quick.
The single best predictor of when you get terrorism is the unemployment rate among 18-year-old males around the world.
Everything else that trumps everything. Yeah. In parts of the North Caucasus, unemployment rates overall are ranging from 50% to 70%, and among young people, they are in many cases 100% in terms of the officially recognized economy. What is the best thing that can be done, and the Russian government is doing some of this, and it's also being helped by Azerbaijan, is trying to build factories to give people jobs. People who are employed and who are integrated into the society in that way are far less likely to listen to any missionary from Al-Qaeda.
Thank you very much. I'm sorry, we have 3 minutes left, and we're going to be a half an hour before we get back. 30 seconds.
Hello, thank you. The 30 seconds, I just want to say that the mention of these committees in Colombia, in Russia, they have started setting up similar committees for the rehabilitation of former fighters, and this is something that I would say would be an area where the U.S. government and Russia would be able to share experiences.
Okay. Thank you very much. We appreciate all of the witnesses, and let us just note at the end, during the Cold War, I was the Soviet Union's worst enemy, nemesis, because I believe that free people need to determine who their number one enemies are and work to try to defeat them. And that doesn't mean that the people you work with are perfect, et cetera. And we did bring down the Soviet Union. We worked with a lot of people who had a lot of faults. Today, radical Islam in China appear to be the main adversaries of people in the free world and the main threat to the free world. I hope we all work together against a religion that will motivate people to murder children and other threats to us and to civilization. This hearing is adjourned.
Better you than me.